Chancellor, for you wanted me to deliver talk here. Finally, I will speak about recent result concerning co-generalization of cottage and operator and Capelli identity related to reflection equation algebra. Finally, cottage joint operator with notion was introduced by Golden, partially Jackson, in 90s. It's very used in the topic devoted to Hurwitz theory. Finally, it devoted to compute Hurwitz number, and so on and so on. Hurwitz and Concevich, Concevich theory. Finally, recently we invented with my colleague Pavel Sofonov an Erlach and Q situation. And I will be speak about with generalization, but only on analytical part of this theory, because the geometrical part connected to Hurwitz number is not my topic. What is the main actor of my communication? So reflection equation algebra is presented here. Here I is a Hecke type solution, I call it Hecke symmetry, to the Braid relation. What is Braid relation? It is well known. Finally, I will present with relation a little bit later. L is a matrix with entries. And so as usual, L1, it is the following product. Finally, it's necessary to understand with a system on the quantity Lyj. If you present explicitly with system with entries, you get a system. And finally, it's necessary to show that the system is a good deformation of the usual system. And usual system, I mean here, instead of R, we put the usual flip P. And if we put here phi, we have a system, meaning that all entries of this matrix commute with each other, nothing more. So it is a deformation of the commutative algebra, which is nothing but symmetric algebra of GLM. Moreover, I would like to mention that with deformation has a good Poisson bracket. If I put your question, was it quantum analog of the enveloping algebra USLM? You answer, of course, that it is just the quantum group. But if you consider quantum group as deformation of the usual enveloping algebra, it is not good deformation in sense of algebraic structure, because this algebra and this one are isomorphic to each other as algebra. Only coproduct structure is deformed here. But this algebra is indeed a deformation of algebraic structure of this algebra. So it's possible to compute the corresponding Poisson structure corresponding to this deformation. Now, consider a matrix composed from entries Lij with commutative entries, and another matrix D composed from partial derivative and partial derivative on the generator of the matrix L are defined as follows. And consider also the following matrix, product of matrix L and G, I denote with L hat. Usually here one put transposed, but I don't put here transposed because in my notation, application of the derivative to this element is as follows. Usually it is transposed application. But now I put the question, if we consider this matrix, so composed from these entries, so what are commutation relations between these entries? The commutation relations are as follows. So you see, we have generator of the enveloping algebra UGLN, nothing more. So it is well known that this algebra has a big in quotation marks, of course, center. This center is generated by the element which are called power sums, traces of any powers of a hard, and sometimes they are called Gelfand-ilms. Okay, what do you know about with algebra? With algebra, enveloping algebra has a big representation theory, irreducible elements of a representation theory. Finally, they are labeled by partitions. For any partition, we can consider this following space and consider the following representation. This representation is irreducible. Now, to such partition lambda, we can associate a Schur polynomial denoted as follows. So Schur polynomial is a particular case of symmetric functions. So if alpha 1, alpha n are indeterminants, so we consider Schur functions. But we will write S lambda depending on a matrix L. So as I write in this form, it means that this quantity, just entries of the matrix L, are alpha 1 and so on. And if we present with in the following form, it's possible to present this element as a following form explicitly via L. So via entries of this matrix. Here, P lambda is idempotent corresponding to the partition lambda. So this idempotence comes from representation theory of the enveloping algebra. And after that, we present this chain of the matrix L. L1, it is L multiplied by identity. L2 is L put it in the second position, and so on, and so on. After we apply trace. So is with this way of present S lambda depending on L explicitly. And I repeat that P lambda is just idempotent corresponding to this partition. I would like to say that in principle, it's necessary to put here tableau. Tableau, because you know that representation of the enveloping algebra depends on lambda and tableau as well. But this expression doesn't depend on tableau, standard tableau, of course. We consider only standard tableau. If we present with Schur function depending on lambda explicitly, we can apply derivative to this expression, to this function. And finally, we consider with element as element of symmetric algebra of GLN, we can apply any partial derivative to elements of this algebra. Consequently, the differential operator W can be is well defined on this algebra. It can be applied to any element of our algebra. So you see, W it is just trace of L hat or trace of this product. It's a very important analog of the classical relation. Now, I want to apply the operator W to Schur function depending on the matrix L. It is eigenvectors of this operator. So we have the following relation. We apply this operator, we have the same eigenvalues finite multiplied by a number. We consider higher analogs of this operator. It is just trace, and so on, and so on. But you see, we put here normal order. It is very important in constructing of Kant and Join operator. Here, delta 1, and so on, it is a number. Finally, with a good ordering, it's possible to consider delta as a partition. I repeat, this operator is classical cut-adjoint operator. But now I would like to mention that this operator are close to Casimir operator. Casimir operator is more or less the same operator, but without normal ordering. This is the difference between two classes of operator. So I state that this function, which is called, you know, sure functions, it also eigenvalue of Casimir operator is the corresponding eigenvalues were computed by Perelomov and Popov many years ago. I would like to mention once more that the notion, the term cut and join analysis was introduced by Gulden in 94, partially in his joint works with Jackson, this notion appeared many times. This analysis arises from combinatorics related to the symmetric groups, and finally it was actively used in the Hurwitz theory by Morozov, Morshakov, and so on, Tanzon recently died, and other. The construction of cut and join operator on symmetric function are habitually expressed via the Pauli sums, in which form the simplest cut and join operator is as follows. So one part of the operator, I forgot which part, is called cut, and another part is called join. So for this reason, we have cut and join operator presented here. But now I pass to constructing Q and Elach on all this stuff. To this end, we need the notion of quantum double. And now I consider our construction of quantum double. So what do we mean by quantum double? It is just two algebra associative at unital, and a transposition called permutation map, which sends A tensor product B to B product A. We transpose to any elements of these algebras. Okay, by quantum double, we mean the data A, B, sigma. Sigma, it is just with permutation map, where sigma is defined by means of a braiding. Braiding, I will speak a little bit later, so it is a generalization mentioned above. But I will speak later in more detail. Different from super flipper. So we also speak about relations, permutation relations instead of permutation map. So AB initial two elements are equal to sigma applied to AB. And so if you have two algebras, associative algebra introduced, for example, quadratic algebra introduced by generating some relation on the generator, it's necessary to check what? It's necessary to check that if we transpose ideal by what we quotient here and by what we quotient here, the ideals are preserved by permutation map sigma. So in this situation, we say that sigma is compatible with the relation in both algebras. Okay, now what is braiding? Braiding, it is operator from space V squared in the same space, subject to this so-called braid relation. It is well known. But I deal with one type of braid, namely Hecke symmetry, because for Hecke symmetry, it is just subject to the following relation, which is called Hecke relation, because for other situation connected to BMV series, Biermann-Wenzel-Murakami, property of the corresponding reflection equation algebra are not good. And in this situation, the property are good. Okay, the most known example of Hecke symmetry comes from the quantum group UQSLN introduced by Jim by Drinfeld. However, I constructed many years ago as an example of Hecke symmetries, which are not deformation of usual flipper, nor super flipper. Now, we are interested in the algebra related to Hecke symmetry. The simplest algebras are symmetric, algebra generated by V, defined as follows, and skew-symmetric algebra defined as follows. Here, with algebra T on V, is a free tensor algebra. Okay, but besides, we have two matrix algebra. Why with algebra is called matrix, it is more or less clear because T is matrix. Here we have no matrix. Here we have matrix and another reflection equation algebra defined by the following system is also introduced via matrix. T and L are two matrices. We deal mostly with Hecke symmetry, which has even Hilbert-Poincaré series of the skew-symmetric algebra associated to R. So it is just a generalization of a Bazón situation. And degree of this polynomial is called the rank. And would like to draw your attention to the facts that in principle, in classical situation, the rank is equal to dimension of the space V. And in general, it is not so. Now, I consider a small deformation of reflection equation algebra. You see, here we have just the same expression as above. And here we have a linear relation. On the right side, we have quadratic elements. On the right side, we have a linear elements. I denote this algebra as follows. And finally, I would like to say that if R tends to the usual flipper, as Q goes to one, the non-modified without linear terms goes to the symmetric algebra with algebra is commutative. Modified reflection equation algebra goes to enveloping algebra. But it is a very surprising fact because you see the modified reflection algebra and non-modified reflection algebra are related by the following change of generating matrices. And finally, for Q generic, which are not equal to plus minus one, we have with isomorphism between two algebra. But with the isomorphism fails when we Q goes to one. Because you know well that symmetric algebra and enveloping algebra are not isomorphic to each other. Okay, assume that in the algebra A, we have one structure more, mainly co-unit, but co-unit compatible with only algebraic structure. Epsilon applied to the product is this product, and epsilon applied to one is one. So it's very natural. I speak nothing about core structure. It is not interesting for us. And now I want to say that if we have quantum double, and if we have epsilon co-unit, we have action of alpha on any element B. So what is action? We take elements A tensor product B, and we transpose by using map sigma and apply co-unit to the second element to R, which now is located on the right side. Okay, so it is not difficult to check that it is a good action. And finally, it is a way how we will introduce partial derivative A acting on the element B, on the second algebra. So the most known the quantum of quantum double is so-called Heisenberg doubles, composed of two algebra. One algebra is additive algebra, and the other one is a reflection equation algebra. It was considered more or less, without using this terminology, by Voronovich, after that by Pyatov, with many call for with Fadeev, Isaev, and so on and so on. It is the most known quantum double. But we introduced with Safonov and partially with Pyatov a new quantum double composed from two reflection equation algebra. One reflection equation algebra A is just modified reflection equation algebra. The second reflection algebra, non-modified reflection algebra, and permutation relations are as follows. So as you wish, it's possible to put here sigma, two points, and finally here a flash. So we have algebra generated by two algebras, and we introduced a new generating matrix D, which is just a fraction M minus one L hat. We have arrived to the following system. This is just a reflection equation for M. Here we have reflection equation for D, but you see instead of R, it's just R in power minus one. And here we have reflection equation, we have permutation relation. And I would like to say that it is not easy to construct a good quantum double. Because if we take any two algebra, how it's possible to introduce a good permutation between two algebra, it is very difficult deal. And here we have constructed an ELAC of differential calculus. You see, the first relation if we replace R by the usual flip P, we have just a matrix with commutative entries. The second matrix is just matrix generated by D. A permutation relation, it is nothing but the following relation is Heisenberg-Weyl algebra. It means nothing but D R derivation of M. So if we introduce action of the epsilon as follows, we have action of partial derivative on M in the usual sense. And our system, it is just a generalization of the system here. Okay, so for example, if I want to apply our partial derivative denoted DAJ to this product, how is possible, it's necessary to proceed? I transpose by using sigma with element and with product, and after that I apply to D with co-unit, and finally I find what is action of partial derivative in our sense, quantum partial derivative on any elements. Okay, now the basic relation between the matrix MD and L hat are as follows. So it is an ELAC of the classical relation mentioned before. So as you wish, it is miracle. It is not easy to invent a good quantum double, but here we have also this relation looking like the classical one. Okay, and now I want to introduce an ELAC of the operator W mentioned above. So it's necessary to apply to this operator, to this product of two matrix, trace. But this trace must be deformed, well adapted to the Hecke symmetry R. It is defined as follows. R an ELAC of the trace. It is the usual trace, but here it's necessary to put a special matrix C, which depends on A. It is just a generalization, as you wish, of the Drinfeld Jimbo construction, because in Jimbo construction you have a choke, no? Okay. It was a whole choke. So it is just a generalization of Drinfeld result. And in Drinfeld situation, when A is Drinfeld A, so here we have a same matrix Q, diagonal matrix Q in power minus 3, Q in power minus 1. Okay. Now, what is property of the trace? Trace in the classical situation possesses the following property. Trace of AB equal to trace BA. And here it's possible to introduce a new commutator between any two elements of our algebra, I denote with commutator A commutator. And trace is equal zero on A commutator. So we replace the usual commutator by with one, and trace is similar to classical one, but it is related to new transposition of elements X and Y. Okay, now the theorem. It belongs, I guess, to, finally, I don't know to whom belongs with theorem. The element called power samsa, denoted as follows, are central in the algebra, non-modified reflection equation, respectively, modified reflection equation. And with elements are analog of Casimir operator when we represent our algebra somewhere. And now our next time aim is to construct a family of representation of this algebra and perform the spectral analysis of the Casimir operator. In our Braden setting, we call them Q Casimir operator, and if we introduce moreover the normal ordering, we have instead of Casimir operator, Q cut adjoint operator. So it is my main object. So you know that Hecke algebra denoted as follows, is composed from element, usual element, subject to Braid relation, and with relation, and Hecke relation as well. Now, I would like to note that for a generic Q, representation theory as a Hecke algebra is similar to representation theory of group algebra of symmetric group. It is a small deformation, but of course, for some number of exceptional value of Q, it is not so. So I speak about general situation. In particular, for any partition of any positive integer and standard tableau denoted A. In Hecke's algebra, there exists a primitive idempotent, analog of the idempotent mentioned above. So now, if we consider the following subspace, so it is a space V in power, and here we apply this projector. So we get a non-reducible, it is irreducible, but it is only conjecture, unfortunately. We can say that it shows that it is a reducible representation, but only it is deformation of like Drinfeld example of the usual flip. In general situation, we don't know demonstration of this factor, but conjecturally with subspace are irreducible. Okay, now, so So now we introduce an ELAC of sure function, lambda r sure function depending on the matrix M. It is just the following formula. Here some product of matrix M, but you see M1 over line it is just M1. And the next MK, it is previous one, but pushed on the next position via the Heike symmetry R. Usual one use is notation in one push on the second position by using the usual flip. It is not situation in our approach. And if we present with a chain of the matrix M, we put here corresponding idempotent mentioned above. And if we apply trace adapted to our situation, we have an ELAC of the sure function in our setting, Q sure function. But I would like to say that finally it is possible to check that which function doesn't depend on A. So tableau doesn't play any role in this construction. But initially it's necessary to put A here. So this is a way to construct Q sure or simply sure polynomials. If we consider particular cases of sure construction, namely symmetric polynomials, complete or elementary, we have respectively symmetrizer and skew symmetrizer in our setting. For example, elementary symmetric polynomials are as follows, and construction of skew symmetrizer, a skew symmetrizer, of course, are introduced by the formula, and so on and so on. In similar way, it's possible to introduce an ELAC of Gelfand elements or power sums. And finally, all these operators are central in our algebra, in a modified reflection equation or non-modified reflection equation. So we have here exhibited, for example, of Casimir operator, a Casimir operator, Q Casimir operator, as usual. Finally, we state that sure functions are eigenvectors of Casimir operator, and cut and joint operator introduced a little bit later. Finally, we have the following proposition shown recently. So if we apply the first Casimir operator to sure function as follows, we have the following formula. It is just the same here, the same element, and here eigenvalues. Eigenvalues is given by the following formula, and here we call this element lambda character. Lambda character is given by the following formula. Here, quantity CY, it is just content on the box containing the number Y. What is content? Content, it is difference between number of column where box is located, a line. So, for example, for the first box, we have 1 minus 1. For the second box, we have 2 minus 1. So content is equal to 1. And so on and so on. Finally, we have the following formula. Okay, now, for the first Casimir operator, we have that trace is equal to the first elementary symmetric function. The corresponding eigenvalues is presented above. Now, if sure polynomials S lambda is eigenvalues of any operator Casimir operator C, we call this quantity lambda character, as I said above. But now, finally, I want to draw your attention that lambda here is generated matrix of non-modified reflection equation algebra. And a little bit later, I pass to modified reflection equation algebra. Lambda character of Casimir operator considered in the previous page can be cast on the following form. It is a small transformation. Where lambda, it is a partition. And now I want to pass to the matrix lambda hat, because I'm really interested in modified reflection equation. And finally, just here, we have the first cut and join operator. Joint operator, but it is not difficult to compute action of the first cut adjoint operator on any sure function, and we have here a similar formula, but now lambda character as follows. I would like to say that by passing to a limit q goes to one, and we suppose that our goes to the usual flipper, we have the following, as you wish, classical formula. Okay. So now, I would like to say the following. You see, if we begin with generating matrix of modified or non-modified reflection equation algebra, we can construct an ELOC of sure function, of elementary symmetric function, and so on, and so on. And finally, we have the following problem. Whether it is true or not, the product of sure function is similar to the classical one. Here, coefficients here in classical situation are given by Littlewood Richardson formula, well known. Finally, I state that in our setting, when M is not the usual matrix, but matrix which is generating matrix solved for reflection equation algebra, the formula is the same. It is not modified. But what is modified? It is just Q and L of Wronsky relation is modified because instead of the classical factor here, coefficient here, we have here Q in power, here Q in power. And so Wronsky relation are modified as follows. And on the here, Richardson, Littlewood Richardson formula is not modified. Newton identity between elementary and full symmetric function is classical. So it is not modified. Okay, now I want to pass to Capelli identity. Capelli identity is the following identity. Determinant of the matrix L hat generated by, which is generating matrix of the usual enveloping algebra, SLN, GLN. If we consider determinant of the following sum, what sum? K is diagonal matrix as follows. So the matrix L is shifted on the diagonal by 0, 1, and so on, and so on. And R determinant is determinant, which is called row determinant. Row determinant is a special way on computing determinant. It is very important here because we have a matrix with non-commutative entries, so it's necessary to present explicitly a way to compute with determinant. It is not evident, but the Capelli identity says that the following product is valid. So here determinant usual because L is composed from commutative element. Here the determinant is usual, and here it's necessary to put a row identity of the following matrix with this Capelli identity. But I would like to say that with determinant in the left side, hand side, can be presented under the following form. So, in one paper where this formula is considered, Akunkov says that we will deal with our matrix, with our matrix technique. So determinant instead of with writing will be presented as the following one. But I would like to say that our matrix techniques is up to me. It's just a matrix where I is not the usual flipper. Of course, in the approach of Akunkov, here it is just the usual flip. So skew symmetrizer here is constructed via the usual flip. And now our Coppelli identity, Q analog of Coppelli identity, is only conjecturally is presented by the following formula. But we checked with formula for low dimensions. So you see here, it is just analog on the of the formula on the previous page. Here it is just Q symmetrizer corresponding to Hecke symmetry, any Hecke symmetry. This formula is very valid in general situation, not only in Dirichlet situation. For any Hecke symmetry is well defined, and the following is valid. And here is factor depending on Q. Here determinant of L, determinant of D, but determinant are a little bit different. Determinant for L is defined by the following formula. Similar, I presented similar formula before, but finally you see traces are traces, of course. Q symmetrizer or symmetrizer at here chain of the matrix cell. Here similar, but you see order of the matrix are not the same because here are minus one. Okay. And with connection, I would like to put the following question. When any determinant defined in the frameworks of our approach can be presented as column determinant or row determinant. Finally, when I saw the Coppelli identity for the first time, I was very surprised why here I should compute determinant as a row determinant or column determinant, or maybe the both, I don't know. And finally, after some study of this question, I would like to conclude the following. So for in general, it is not possible to use row or column writing. It is not possible in general. But if we have a skew invertible, I repeat, allows us to define traces adapted to R. So for any skew invertible Hecke symmetry R, the quantum determinant for the generating matrix of the corresponding non-modified reflection equation algebra can be defined as explained above. So if we have a deformation of the usual flip, it's possible to define quantum determinant, but moreover, if I is a deformation of the usual flip, for instance, it is just a Dirichlet Hecke symmetry or Cramer-Gervais Hecke symmetry, because Cramer-Gervais is a deformation of the usual flip as well. It is not well known. With symmetry corresponding to quartic group is well known, but this one is not. The quantum determinant can be presented, cast under the form of either row or column determinant. The both writing are possible. As for modified reflection equation algebra, the answer is possible if with matrix, the generating matrix of the with enveloping algebra. In our Q situation, it is not yet known whether writing column or row is possible. By concluding my talk, I would like to make two historical remarks. Finally, the first attempt to introduce Q analog of the Coppelli identity was undertaken by with team of Japanese many years ago. But finally, I don't like with Capelli identity because their construction is related to RTT algebra. If even we consider with Capelli identity with a standard Drinfeld-Hecke symmetry, which comes from the quantum groups, with Capelli identity is not deformation of the classical one. And we are interested in QNL, which are deformation of the classical one, and goes to the classical one when R goes to P. The second observation, in which here Akuňkov introduced the notion of quantum immanent. And I would like to stress that our technique is also can be applied to introduce coanalog with object. This is the end of my talk. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, dear Dimitri. Are there questions, remarks, or comments?
Can you define a quantum Blücher relation? Can you define Blücher relation, quantum Blücher relation?
For the moment, no. I understand the interest of this question, but I thought about this, but for the moment, I know nothing to say about.
Quantum Capelli is special.
I understand your question. Now, in principle, I try to understand what is QNL of tau function. And it's near your question. And finally, it is not so easy to do it. Finally, for example, I can now introduce QNL of Dirac C, two fermions, some relations. It is not so easy, but I know to do it. But how it's necessary to introduce analogous tau functions is difficult because it's necessary to know what is exponent of some bosonic element, bosonic composed from fermionic elements. And what is analog of exponent of bosonic elements, it is not so easy to understand because in the classical situation, if you take a fermion, Dirac fermion, you transpose other side of exponent, you can compute a commutation relation. In Q situation, I don't know how it's possible to do. So what is Q analog of the exponent? I don't know.
Other questions? I have a small question about you spoke for the generic case, as you said.
The generic case in what sense?
Yes, the equalgebras and the UQ. Okay. Do you have some insights of what happens in the degenerate cases?
Degenerated?
Yes, degenerated.
The degenerated in one sense. Finally, if Q goes to 1 and R goes to P, it means that it is generalization as you wish. But in what sense do you mean generated? Because I don't understand.
Yes, all depends the Ecker algebra you take. With the spectral deformation is minus 1 or 2 or minus 1. Q minus 2 to the minus 1 and Q, you have degenerated cases. You know this, but do you have some insights of what could happen?
Finally, I don't understand well your question about degenerated. What does it mean, degenerated? In what sense? To ponyo?
Okay.
We can discuss later.
Yes, because we don't.
After eating.
Yes.
Eating first.
So now it is just the occasion to discuss later with lunch time. So we thank the speaker again.